Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wild New World, the epic story of animals and people in America, by Dan Flores, read by Clark Cornell. That which happens to men also happens to animals, and one thing happens to them both. As one dies, so dies the other, for they share the same breath, and man has no preeminence above an animal, for all is vanity. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 19. There is grandeur in this view of life. Whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. Charles Darwin, On the Origin of Species. Introduction. All is vanity. It was the lead-up to a presidential election, an unsettling late summer for many Americans, since the hugely popular incumbent, Theodore Roosevelt, was declining to run for president a second time. The national gossip centered around whether portly William Howard Taft, who Roosevelt handpicked as his successor at Chicago's Republican Convention that June of 1908, could possibly follow the charismatic advocate of the strenuous life. Somehow Taft seemed an unlikely replacement for the president, who does not shrink from danger, from hardship. So the news story out of the remote Southwest late that August initially seemed little more than a momentary distraction from politics, even if, for some, it might have been a reminder of the kind of heroic leadership the country was losing. What the nation read in its newspapers was that on the night of August 27th, a 65-year-old telephone operator named Sally Rook had gotten a call that an immense thunderstorm hovering over the Colorado-New Mexico border had spawned a flash flood in the dry Cimarron River. With a debris-choked wall of water ripping straight for the town of Folsom, New Mexico, Rook had spent a crucial half-hour frantically calling every local number on her switchboard, saving scores of people. Then the flood had torn through Folsom and swept her away, along with half the town. Sally Rook's heroism became a national story. Telephone operators around the country contributed thousands of dimes for a memorial, but eventually the story faded from the papers. Folsom had imagined itself competing with Colorado Springs 100 miles up the Rockies, but the town never recovered. Today, Colorado Springs has 500,000 people. Folsom has 80. In the days immediately following the dry Cimarron flood, an African-American cowboy named George McJunkin was riding through grassy parkland a few hundred yards below the rim rock of a miles-long mesa that extended eastward from the Rocky Mountains, checking for ranch fence lines damaged by the flood. Suddenly, McJunkin's horse braced, its hooves furrowing into foot-deep mud at the edge of a ragged scar floodwaters had cut into the slope below the mesa. McJunkin leaned out of his saddle to peer into a fresh chasm sliced into the brown shale. What he saw changed the story of America forever. On a similar rainy August day in 2018, some 35 of us are stepping through the lush grass of that same slope as it angles up towards the rim rock of Johnson Mesa. We're following David Eck, a New Mexico State Land Office archeologist with a long ponytail halfway down his back, who is leading us toward the very spot where George McJunkin's horse had pulled up 110 years ago. A century of floods and cattle grazing has changed the look of the place, which the flood erosion of 1908 had exposed as an ancient box canyon. The topography is now a grassy, shallow drain called Wild Horse Arroyo, and as we crowd around its edges, it seems somehow too commonplace to be the scene of one of the continent's most significant historical finds. Nonetheless, this in the flesh is the legendary Folsom archaeological site. It's the place where the world found irrefutable proof that we humans had been intimately involved with American wild animals that long ago went extinct. What McJunkin had done about where we now stood talking was to spot in the flood-gashed arroyo bones of an immense size he had never seen before. The exposed skeletal materials turned out to be from a herd of bison antiquus, an extinct form of giant bison. but the bones themselves weren't the pièce de résistance. At the time, the sciences of ethnology and archaeology in the United States were firm that American Indians had arrived in North America only a couple thousand years prior to the coming of Europeans. In the Old World, artifact hunters at France's La Madeleine Rock Shelter in 1864 had found a piece of ivory with a representation of a mammoth on it. That seemed certain evidence that in Europe, humans once coexisted with extinct Pleistocene animals. As early as the 1870s, popular magazines in Europe were carrying illustrations of humans doing heroic battle against monsters like cave bears and mammoths. That such sights hadn't turned up in the United States fed into a bias, going back to a famous debate in the late 1700s between the French naturalist Comte de Buffon and Thomas Jefferson about whether America really was marginal to the global biological and human story. History has taken Jefferson's side in their argument, but Buffon turned out to be right about one aspect. In contrast to Jefferson, who thought extinction impossible, the French naturalist convinced the world that the strange creatures quarrymen were unearthing in Europe and America were species that had once roamed Earth, but were now long vanished. Buffon likewise annoyed Jefferson by casting aspersions on American Indians' assumed lack of a significant history compared to that of Europe. In 1908, the flood that swept away Sally Rook and George McJunkin's discovery in the wake of it were about to change forever the narrative that America was marginal to humanity's deep story. Since Jefferson's time, scientists and ordinary citizens had been looking for something to refute old world snobbery about America's past. In the wake of the La Madeleine discovery in France, the Smithsonian had mailed a circular asking military officers, missionaries, and Indian agents to be on the lookout for ancient fossil sites that might also show human antiquity. The stakes for demonstrating a deep human past in America were huge, and over time, amateurs and scientists of various stripes advocated for at least 24 sites, from Florida to New Jersey, from Idaho to California, as possible evidence humans had been in America in the Pleistocene. They thought they'd found it in 1882, when footprints embedded in stone at the Nevada State Prison seemed to show mammoth tracks overlapping human prints. That led to an excited New York Times headline, "Footprints of Monster Men." Famous paleontologist Edward Drinker Cope thought the account convincing, but when University of California geologist Joseph LeConte went to investigate, he concluded that the Monster Man tracks were in fact those of a giant ground sloth. A classic late summer thunderstorm was brewing up over Johnson Mesa as David Eck was explaining to us that until his death in 1922, George McJunction proselytized about his find to anyone who would listen. 4 years later, in 1926, the black cowboy's plea to have a scientist look at his bone pit finally reached Jesse Figgins, director of the Colorado Museum of Natural History in Denver. Something of an amateur at this game, Figgins was mostly interested in fossil bison that might make exhibits in his museum. His team began an excavation of the site in May of 1926, and quickly began finding the skeletal remains of bison of an enormous size. That was exciting enough, but in their second season of work, on August 29th, 1927, Figgins' crew troweled up Big History Pay Dirt. As David Eck was gesturing to the dimensions of this near-century-old dig, in the pockets of my light Patagonia jacket, my fingers closed over an object that I could fit into my palm. In shape, it was oblate. Think a flattened football, but with an end bitten off. Beneath my fingers, I could feel an irregular surface, made so by labor-intensive flaking to create a pointed blade that dwindled to a remarkably thin base. The delicacy of that base was a result of matching flutes, skillfully popped from the flint on both sides. Actually, the object in my hand was not the real thing. It was a cast bronze piece an artist friend once made for me. Today, residents of Folsom aver that McJunkin himself had found a real point of this kind. In that first summer of digging, Figgins's paleontologists had unearthed two of them in the loosed dirt of the site. Eventually, the Denver team would find 8 of these stunning fluted points scattered among the bones. But it wasn't just the points that made Folsom what American Museum of Natural History scientist Henry Fairfield Osborne labeled the greatest event in American discoveries. In July of 1926, Scientific American had published an article by a famous Smithsonian anthropologist claiming that there is no valid evidence that the Indian has long been in the New World. That view was consigned to the junkyard of scientific theory in August of 1927, when the second season crew at Folsom flicked the dirt from the ribs of an extinct bison and were greeted by the sight of one of these fluted points solidly embedded to two-thirds its length in the bone. The bar for proof that humans were part of the American Pleistocene had always been an extinct animal preserving evidence that as a living creature it had been killed by human technology. Now, outside the tiny burg of Folsom, New Mexico, that bar was hurdled in a way no Smithsonian scientist could deny. Leaving their discovery exactly as they found it, Figgins' team at once sent telegrams urging archaeologists to come and see. As it happened, a star witness was available. The most famous archaeologist in America was Alfred Kidder, who that summer was hosting the first of his PICOS conferences on the Southwestern Past. Kidder came, looked, and declared to the world that America, too, had an antiquity. How much of an antiquity was still in question, because radiocarbon dating was yet three decades in the future. For his part, Figgins claimed the site was 400,000 years old. Eventually, archaeology and paleontology would agree that on an October day, a band of three dozen humans had driven into a box canyon, killed and butchered 32 giant bison of the species Bison antiquus in the spot where I was now standing, and they had done this 12,450 years ago. No one knows what these ancient bison hunters called themselves or their weapons. Their beautiful fluted points were likely attached to darts thrown by atlatls or spear throwers. But not knowing much about these early Americans didn't prevent the scientists from naming both the points and the people Folsom after the nearby town. I worked the bronze replica in my pocket through my fingers like a card dealer in Vegas. It was exquisitely, almost deliciously crafted. It was also a replica of the kind of artful technology we humans have used to hunt and too often destroy much of the bestiary of the continent. But the Folsom era, there was indeed a Folsom America, was not the first time we humans had pursued distinctive American animals to their extinction, and it was very far from being the last. That long-term relationship between our species and wild animals in North America, which includes human-driven losses of other species in our deep history and staggeringly selfish and myopic destruction in our much more recent past, is an uncomfortable reveal about our species and our time on the planet. But our future demands we look it in the eye, look ourselves in the eye, and face this particular American story. Because they lay so far around the planet from humanity's origins in Africa, the Americas were the last continents we humans found in our grand explorations of planet Earth. North America was an unimaginable location that we initially struggled to find at all. Then, like some valuable heirloom we kept misplacing, America disappeared and receded from human knowledge again and again. The result was a lost continent that would function as a wild new world more than once, and for more than one people. Folsom, it turned out, wasn't the American Book of Genesis after all. 6 years after the Folsom discovery, there was another dramatic revelation, and in an unlikely place. Out on the featureless sweeps of the country's middle, an ordinary gravel excavation near a tiny farming town named Clovis exposed the bones of long-extinct American elephants. Science and the reading public knew that America had harbored various kinds of giant elephants in the deep past, but unlike 19th-century mastodon finds in the East, this time, the skeletons were intermixed with the projectile points and tools of an unknown culture that was apparently even more ancient than the Folsom people. Across the next decade, as these larger and also fluted flint points began to show up all over America, from Alaska to Florida, from New England and the Midwest to the Southwest, scientists puzzled over who these elephant hunters might be. At a conference in Santa Fe in 1941, they decided to name them after the locale where their inhabitation of the continent first came to light. So, we added Clovis to America's lengthening human-animal story. When radiocarbon dating finally assigned them to a time frame, the elephant hunters turned out to have occupied the continent Europeans once called the New World many thousands of years before any European city was born. The animals these hunters killed and butchered with brightly striped flint tools across every region of America died more than 13,000 years before the United States existed. Hitherto unsuspected American beginnings like Folsom and Clovis were turning what everyone thought a brief history, European colonization leading to the creation of the United States, into an epic older than anyone's written history or any human memory. Americans hearing about the continent's new human antiquity couldn't help feeling uneasy. The elephants and giant bison were gone. So were the camels and horses and giant cats whose remains fossil hunters had been excavating since the 1850s from places like the asphalt pools in downtown Los Angeles. Human weaponry and tools were now turning up in clear association with many of these extinct animals. That hardly seemed a coincidence in the 1920s and 1930s, decades when a remarkable number of species from the modern United States were also vanishing one after another. Americans of the time barely recognized mammoths or camels as part of the continent's bestiary, but there were people still alive in the 1920s who had seen with their own eyes millions of bison and billions of passenger pigeons. As with camels and elephants, though, by the 1920s those scenes were no longer a part of America. Just a few years before, the last living individual of the most numerous bird species on Earth had died in her cage at the Cincinnati Zoo. Americans celebrated in the early 1930s when an organization called the American Bison Society announced that the buffalo, the most iconic of all our mammals, would not go extinct after all. But it was a Pyrrhic victory. Bison lived, rescued on the brink of their demise, but not to return to the wild. Instead, they were enclosed in preserves so curious citizens could marvel and wonder what happened to an animal that once numbered in the millions. And it wasn't just passenger pigeons and buffalo. A legacy of animal cleansing was visible everywhere you looked in the United States of the 1920s. The year Figgins's crew initiated the dig at Folsom was the same year gray wolves howled for the last time in America's first national park, Yellowstone. By then, we had poisoned, trapped, and shot wolves into near extirpation across most of the country. That slaughter was more than symbolic. It meant that a dominant keystone predatory animal, whose mere presence had powerfully shaped North American ecologies across the past 5 million years of history, was now almost gone from the continent south of Canada. At the same time, ornithologists announced that, like passenger pigeons, our giant ivory-billed woodpeckers appeared to be extinct. So did our sole native parrot, the Carolina parakeet. In New England, newspapers year by year tracked the demise of the eastern version of the prairie chicken, known as the heath hen, until the final bird, a last lonely male, was gone. None of us born in the past century has gotten to see any form of a biologically complete America. We all exist in a world handed down by the prior occupants. Like coming generations, who will have to live with a planet our generations have overheated, we too suffer from the selfishness of those who lived before us. In our case, our ancestors left us a simplified and devastated Earth. Sitting down to his journal one morning in 1856, Henry David Thoreau enumerated and lamented all the wild creatures missing from the New England of his time because of the myopia and self-interest of the colonial demigods who got there first. What he longed for, enough that it ached, he wrote, was an entire heaven and an entire Earth. In the years that produced both the Folsom and Clovis discoveries, along with widespread modern extinctions, Americans were among the most optimistic people on the planet. We basked in the sense of having turned the tide in the Great War. Our institutions seemed to offer the best future for humanity, and our popular culture was on its way to global domination. Maybe there were a few dark clouds looming, but losing American animals was a minor thing in the big picture, especially since the country seemed to believe that no one and no institutions were really to blame. Birds and animal species were just casualties of progress and civilization, we told ourselves, collateral damage in the act of creating the best country in the world. Explanations like this prevailed for decades. But a century later, our excuses are crumbling in the face of powerful evidence of our culpability. The modern genetic revolution is a scientific breakthrough for the ages, rivaling the discovery of evolution itself, and is now at a sprint fixed on writing a history that stretches far more deeply into the past than human memory. Genetics and genomics are not only transforming our knowledge of how America acquired its remarkable diversity of life, these sciences are increasingly suggesting what caused us to lose so many of the species that have disappeared. The answers from both history and science are the subject of many of the following sections. I won't say more here, beyond preparing you for this. Woolly mammoths, Colombian mammoths, flightless sea ducks, great auks, heath hens, bison, pronghorns, beavers, sea otters, fur seals, bald eagles, hummingbirds, whooping cranes, snowy egrets, trumpeter swans, peregrine falcons, California condors, jaguars, cougars, alligators, rattlesnakes, gray wolves, red wolves, Mexican wolves, eastern wolves, grizzly bears, wild horses, passenger pigeons, Carolina parakeets, prairie dogs, black-footed ferrets, coyotes, spotted owls, and ivory-billed woodpeckers all have both deep histories and modern stories that resemble one another more than you think. We're uncomfortable thinking of ourselves as having been carnivores, as killers. For that matter, we're not used to thinking of ourselves as a species, preferring terms like the human race. And we almost never act as if we're another of Earth's animals. But of course, we are all those things, and all are a part of our big history. The sweeping story I tell here, then, is an extension of human history back to our origins as animals, along with the evolutionary adaptations that helped make us who we are. Because it draws a bigger circle around time and subjects, big history has advantages over conventional history. It can acknowledge that the destiny of a continent like North America lies not just with us, but also with our fellow creatures and the larger evolutionary stream in which we all swim. That story unfolded beneath the grand forces that shaped American biology across the past 66 million years, from the Paleocene to now, and those forces fashioned some of our planet's most remarkable life forms, from hummingbirds to Colombian mammoths. Late in that larger trajectory was our own evolution, the appearance of an intensely social omnivore who became master of the planet by reinventing itself as an even more social carnivore. Some will already know the shorthand version of this. As predators, we spread out of Africa, migrating all over the world in search of animal prey. Our close ancestors pushed beyond their African homeland almost a million years ago, and our species joined that quest to explore the larger planet some 60,000 years ago. In the past 25,000 years, a few of us happened on the Americas, the last best place of human exploration, and sometime after 16,000 years ago, more of us arrived to create America's first shore-to-shore human society, profoundly altering the ancient bestiary. We did it all once more 5 centuries ago, when old worlders transplanted themselves and their economies, cultures, and ideas to the continent's existing world of peoples and animals, and then, like some new contagion spreading inland from the coasts, proceeded to effect a widespread demolition of almost all that was there. This is our cross to bear, and one of the inescapable truths of big history. According to a 2018 National Academy of Sciences study, as our predatory genus Homo spread across the planet, Earth lost roughly 300 mammal species, sacrificing more than 2.5 billion years of unique evolutionary history. The migrations that ultimately led us to America during the Pleistocene erased a shocking 2 billion years of evolved mammalian genetic diversity. Across the past 500 years, Human-caused extinctions have cost Earth another 500,000 years of cumulative genetics. And that's the mammals alone, never mind the birds and reptiles. As the Academy of Sciences authors put the matter, this means that prehistoric and historic extinctions were close to worst-case scenarios. To lay out the wildlife story of those last five centuries in another way, since 1500, we Americans have managed to commit the largest single destruction of wild animals discoverable in modern history. In the early 20th century, there were former market hunters who believed they ought to get national medals of commendation for their role in that. So fair warning, some of the stories in this book won't be easy to hear or process. But take heart. Our full awakening amid the rich life of the planet also bequeathed to humanity an undertow of wonder and fascination for other creatures in Earth's evolutionary stream. The late Harvard scientist E.O. Wilson has called this core human value biophilia, which he defined as a genetic memory of our emergence, a piercing love affair with the other life forms that surround us on the planet. Our sense of this magic and romance is visible in the enthralled renderings of animals we painted on the walls of Europe's limestone caverns and on miles of cliffs in the Serranía La Lindosa forests in South America. Biophilia was certainly there when Americans deliberately said no to destruction and loss and passed the most significant law in wild animal history, the Endangered Species Act of 1973 and its recovery programs dedicated to the ultimate democratic proposition that every species has a right to exist are this country at its best. They are also a course correction that those battling to rescue Earth from an overheated climate should feel some optimism about. We have it in ourselves to change. A love of diverse life as old as our origins was always there to call on, and when we have done so, we've bathed human history in a brighter light. This complex American story produced many inspiring, empathetic heroes, from native peoples who preserved a wild continent largely intact for 10,000 years, to naturalists compelled to know every detail of continental animal life, from visionaries who gave the world its first national parks to writers, activists, and politicians who confronted the destruction and loss of wild animals before it was too late. Always there have been scientists describing and classifying exotic new species until accumulated experience and knowledge finally yielded up the grand insight about the diversity of life and our own origins. Others made breakthroughs that caused us to question our persecutions of America's anciently evolved predator guild, the canids, bears, and big cats. Most recently, science is rewriting biological histories while helping us understand that the self-awareness and cultural richness we celebrate as human place us within animal life, not outside it. All is vanity to think otherwise. These and more are part of this story. But this is still a narrative leavened with pathos, because while we adore the diversity of our remaining birds and animals and marvel at them as our species always has, we've always been most concerned about our own self-interest. Those particular angels of our nature account for where we are in the 21st century, with a continuing sixth and massive extinction of wildlife forms underway in America and across Earth, and with at least some of us dreading that outcome. In the early 2000s, the chemist and Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen popularized a new term in global languages, the Anthropocene epoch, designating the moment in history when human impacts on Earth had become so dominant as to transform our planet in ways formerly reserved for extraterrestrial impacts or geological upheavals. Scientists since have debated whether the designation is proper, and if it is, and most of the public that has heard of the idea think it is, when it might have begun. At a time when climate change is all on our minds, Crutzen and his supporters have pointed to the Industrial Revolution and the onset of our fossil fuel economy as the obvious beginning point for an age when humans became Earth's most powerful force. Others have insisted on a starting date even more recent, in the 1940s, with the dawn of the Atomic Age, which for the first time put a technology in the hands of the human species capable of destroying most life on Earth with the press of a button. But standing here, in Wild Horse Arroyo in 2018, as a massive storm cell gathers itself to shoot lightning daggers at the mesa overhead, I can't help entertaining an alternative theory for the Anthropocene. The replica Folsom Point in the pocket of my jacket and the animal bones pulled out of the ground here imply to me a much deeper time frame for our species' transformation of the planet. Indeed, the Dutch curators of the History Database of the Global Environment have suggested that the Neolithic Revolution, widespread farming, animal domestication, and the emergence of cities a few thousand years ago might offer a more apt beginning for the Anthropocene. As for me, I'm more in line with the archaeologists like our ponytailed guide. A panel of his colleagues from around the world argued a few years ago that if we're really serious about dating a global Anthropocene, if we truly want to discover when our species' planet-altering impact began, we have to look much further back in time than even the Neolithic, at what happened to the world's animals, those victims of a love affair gone bad when we humans fully settled Earth. Chapter 1. A Prologue in Deep Time. What wakes me is a sound I've never heard, or to be truer to the moment, two sounds. One is a soft, gentle sort of chuffing. Coming awake to the slanting light out the tent door, I register this one first, an auditory accompaniment to the angled light, which lands in my foggy brain as a language I can't quite translate. The other sound is almost as delicate, but more percussive. It appears to reach from the far away to the nearby, a tinkling with a thousand source points. It is June 22nd, the day after summer solstice, 2019, and with my wife, Sarah, and eight of our friends, I am waking in what seems to be primeval America. We are in Alaska, above the Arctic Circle, at nearly 70 degrees north latitude, and that far up the curve of the planet, on summer solstice, we're experiencing a new cosmic reality, a powerful sense of being just off the apex of a gigantic sphere that's spinning beneath a light source the universe has forgotten to switch off. No matter how early or late you go to bed or wake, the same fingers of dawn, sunlight, and shadowing await you. From our put-in high in the Brooks Range, we're now 9 days down the Hulahula River, named by or for a Hawaiian islander on a ship pursuing wealth in furs here 2 centuries ago. By now we're out in the vast coastal plain of America's crown jewel, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, and while the oblique light angles never relent, these far away and nearby sounds are new. The source points are hooves of thousands of caribou migrating out of mountains filled with wolf packs down to the relative safety of the Arctic plain, where they are coming to drop their calves. Herd after herd is passing by within 100 feet of our camp this morning, conversing in a murmur that audibly rises above the flow of the nearby river. Pulling the tent fabric aside, my first guess is that the tinkling is the clicking of caribou hooves passing through the stiff 8-inch-high willows blanketing the riverside tundra. But the more I listen, the more it sounds like a popping in their leg joints as they walk. The chuffing? That seems to be quiet caribou conversation. For days, we've floated downriver among these herds, and now everywhere we look, they are the only upright things in an otherwise horizontal world, tan and white bodies rocking along in a kind of slow-motion parade. They seem aimed toward an indistinct assortment of white blocks, miles out, we're now grasping our icebergs in the Arctic Ocean. On the opposite riverbank, only yards away, herd males with antlers and faces black as squid ink clack over the rocks. There are pregnant cows, also with antlers, posses of adolescents, and infrequently a black wolf or grizzly out in the opalescent distance. Some herds with brand new calves, the little guys jetting and pogoing across the tundra, have abandoned the relentless march northward from the mountains. 10 days earlier, in Arctic Village, Netsalgwichin tribal elder Sarah James told us that the porcupine caribou herd is 300,000 strong. Funny, eloquent, with long silver streaked hair, 75-year-old Sarah travels the world fighting to keep oil drilling out of the refuge, a looming threat in 2019. She's got the bona fides for it. That tribal name means people of the caribou. The caribou are in our hearts, and we are in theirs, she told us. Standing by my tent, surrounded by perhaps 10,000 caribou moving slowly through a vast grassy landscape, I'm dumbfounded. I'm also struck by the realization that for the first time in my life, I'm experiencing a version of an entire America, the continent human eyes have been marveling over for more than 20,000 years. In the second decade of this century, what's required for a primal experience of the natural planet is being in one of Africa's grand game parks, in parts of the Amazon, or in some wildly remote piece of North America. That spawns another thought. Are we capable anymore of remembering what we've sacrificed, that once these caribou and wolves would have been joined by grazing woolly mammoths and vast zebra-like herds of wild horses? In the United States of the 21st century, this wild coastal plain in sight of the Beaufort Sea is one of the last continental places to preserve a tantalizing echo of wild America as it waited across the millennia for its destiny to play out. The wild new world that greeted the first human arrivals was a more ancient place by far than humanity itself. Immense time and relentless evolution, plus at least one cosmic wild card that sent history off in a dramatic new direction, had painted a wondrous canvas of biological life in North America. Yet historical unpredictability lay in the seams of the Americas we humans found. The one certain truth about our Earth is that everything could have turned out very differently. It was that shock to the timeline that sets this story in motion. Four times in the planet's early history, it had suffered and ultimately survived global extinction events. Earth's fifth extinction event was a special one. Given the evidence for widespread planetary bombardment elsewhere in our solar system, we have to assume cosmic collisions on Earth aren't exactly rare. A few years ago, I walked the rim of a remarkable half-mile-wide impact crater in northern Arizona that offers surviving evidence of that. But on planets where life has evolved, even fairly common impacts are dangerous because they threaten ecological disruptions. The one in question, though, wasn't common, and this was especially unlucky for North America because its landmasses were in the bullseye of one of Earth's biggest contingency events. 66 million years ago, North America was not even a single piece of ground yet. The continent was in two major pieces, with the Western Interior Seaway inundating much of today's southeast, and from the Great Plains to the Great Basin. This shallow ocean entirely separated the eastern landmass Appalachia from the large western chunk Laramidia. Dominated by dinosaurs and reptilian life, those halves were already hinting at some of the differences that would characterize Eastern and Western America. With the Appalachian uplift already in its past, the Eastern piece was geologically calm, sedate, buttoned up. The Western landmass, closer to the active volcanic hotspots of the Pacific Ocean, churned with geological activity and reinvention. Although the Rocky Mountains had not yet soared skyward, tectonic plate collisions were already lifting the Sierra Nevada and Cascade ranges. The simple fact that mountains existed both east and west would prove important in what was about to happen. The approaching contingency was 7.5 miles in diameter, a rocky chunk ejected from the outer asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. It had almost certainly crossed Earth's orbit many times in the planet's history, whizzing by within sight of the life below. Millions of years in the future, scientists would recognize this Death Star as a carbonaceous chondrite, one of the most common of the various meteorites. What distinguished this one was its gargantuan size and the speed of its approach. The cosmic projectile was hurtling at 27,000 miles per hour, and as it approached Earth, the bottom end of the Western Interior Seaway assumed form directly below it. Today, that's the northwestern tip of Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula, near the Mayan Pueblo of Chicxulub, a village that now graces this solar system-level event with its interesting lyrical name. Since the late 1990s, we have assumed the Chicxulub asteroid's impact angle was low, that it was traveling from south to north with its primary destructive force aimed directly at North America. Extensive seismic and geophysical mapping of the site, downloaded into 3D modeling programs, has now led to a different conclusion. The asteroid seems instead to have approached its strike zone from the northeast and at a steeply inclined angle of 45 to 60 degrees. No glancing hit, this. The enormous rock smacked into an immovable backstop of water, mud, rock, and life at an angle guaranteed to pack the atmosphere with impact debris. It also hit during the rebirth of spring in the northern hemisphere, which made everything worse. There has not been a spectacle even close to this on Earth for the past 66 million years, and that's a fortunate thing. According to a Los Alamos National Lab modeling of what happened, the unimaginable ferocity of the collision blew open a surface crater 18 miles deep and 124 miles wide within mere seconds. The hit instantly vaporized the asteroid itself, and because its strike was in ocean water, it generated tsunamis a mile tall that ricocheted off Earth's shorelines, water sloshing to and fro across a planetary bowl for weeks afterward. Those produced ripples on the ancient seafloor the height of five-story buildings. The next act was an ejecta of molten rock shot into Earth's atmosphere to such heights that it rained down scalding glass that burned the planet's vegetation to ash. That column soared so high its top exited Earth's orbit, and over the next few million years deposited bits of our planet across the Moon, Mars, and Jupiter and its moons. Some astrobiologists believe that while Chicxulub came close to extinguishing life on Earth, its strike on a planet teeming with living things may have seeded life in the form of microbes throughout much of the solar system. In the aftermath, Earth famously experienced not just a nuclear winter, but a toxic one. Dust and ash saturated the atmosphere. Trillions of tons of sulfur and carbon dioxide, along with billions of tons of methane and carbon monoxide, were hoisted into the biosphere by this giant petard. Everything that hadn't been blasted in a shockwave, or burned by molten rain, or frozen under dense cloud cover was now drizzled with sulfuric acid. Most terrestrial species were extinguished. Fewer than 25% of Earth's life forms survived. With such a steeply angled hit, Chicxulub's effects were distributed symmetrically across the planet. But the continental pieces that made up North America were basically fried. Chicxulub came desperately close to exterminating life on the continent. Only three spots, above the Arctic Circle and in mountainous recesses beyond the Appalachians and Sierra Cascades, were sufficiently shielded to preserve continental plant life. The impact wiped clean the hard drive of evolutionary life all over the planet, but particularly in America. With dinosaurs now at an end, new life would be based on the relative handful of forms that survived. Chicxulub was our premier contingency. Without it, no us, because critical among those few survivors were small, scurrying, rat-sized creatures, warm-blooded, and capable of rapid generational turnover, where natural selection could work on them quickly. They were mammals, of course, and with no warning, they had now inherited a planet with thousands of vacant ecological niches to fill just as fast as evolution could shape them for the tasks. One American place we know witnessed the miracle of rebirth in the Paleocene, as the epoch following Chicxulub is called, is a canyonated country just east of the Colorado Rockies called Coral Bluffs. The skulls paleontologists have found there tell a story of by-the-fingernails mammalian resilience. Ground-dwelling rat-sized mammals survived the extinction event far better than tree-dwelling raccoon-sized ones did. But within about 100,000 years after Chicxulub, mammals were finding Earth's new possibilities to their liking. By then, creatures as large as raccoons were reappearing in Colorado. Some 300,000 years post-asteroid, more warm-blooded terrestrials appear in the record. Some of them, like creatures scientists have named Loxolophus and Carcioptichus, were the size of small pigs. By fewer than a million years after Chicxulub, there were mammals in America called euconodons, as big as wolves or large dogs. Of the grand forces shaping American nature, proximity may have been the most important. The two landmasses that made up future North America were not completely isolated from the rest of the world. In a pattern that would continue down the arc of millions of years and would eventually bring humans to America, connections to other continents formed, vanished, formed again. North America East periodically connected via Greenland with the northern reaches of Europe, while other less ephemeral land bridges linked North America West to Asia. Those connections formed in cold climate pulses, then melted away under rising seas in warm ones. And each time the connections persisted, even for a few centuries, the possibilities for more diversity in North American life expanded, for elsewhere around the world, mammalian and other life was recreating in abundance of forms just as it was in future Colorado. 5 million years after the Chicxulub impact, another grand event, the Laramide uplift, this one precipitated by colliding continental plates in the west, elevated the Rocky Mountains and drained the interior seaway down the present Mississippi Valley. North American East and North America West then merged as a single continent. But the two former halves seemed to preserve their own particular geologies and life connections, the East more like Europe in its vegetation and life forms, the West, in truth, a part of Asia. In the wake of Chicxulub, North American life struggled through millions of years to regain its prior diversity. In the northern latitudes of Europe, Asia, and Africa, a similar process was unfolding, but the closest connections to North America all lay through an Arctic filter that restricted the sorts of creatures that could colonize a recovering continent. The native species that had best made it through the impact were the aquatics, turtles, alligators, amphibians, reptiles, and ancestors of ancient fishes like gars and paddlefishes. Already nearly 150 million years old, American alligators somehow survived Chicxulub and eventually shared the southern coastline with giant ocean-going American crocodiles. The ancestor of pit vipers also survived, although an American subfamily found nowhere else on Earth, the rattlesnakes did not begin to differentiate into its 36 separate species until 12 to 14 million years ago. As with alligators and rattlesnakes, rewilding post-Chicxulub America from indigenous forms meant that with sufficient time, the continent would again become a laboratory of explosive evolution. Life is important to itself and to the ecologies it occupies without any reference to us. But many of the life forms that emerged in North America from 66 million years ago down to our own recent arrival would become critical players in human history. However, for a striking number of them, recent human history has obscured their origins as distinctive American contributions to Earth's life. Within the first 10 million years after Chicxulub, continental evolution had already begun shaping many such animals. Among the oldest were the earliest versions of what became the equidae, the family of horses and burros. Emerging first as rabbit-sized forest creatures in the Paleocene epoch, 66 to 56 million years ago, American horses rapidly evolved into much larger forms during the Miocene epoch, 23.8 to 5.3 million years ago, in response to large-scale climate and vegetation alterations across the northern hemisphere. In time, as many as a dozen different types shared the tundras and grasslands of America. Paleontologists have excavated horse remains from Alaska to Florida, where horses make up 60% of Miocene fossils, and in almost every state south of the Great Lakes. Today's genus Equus, which includes the horses we all recognize, was in place by 4 million years ago. At the time humans were first exploring America's wild new world, in some geographies those horses made up 25% of the biomass of all living creatures. Horse history also corrects any supposition that the occasional connective bridges that linked America with the rest of the world were one-way streets. Whenever land bridges formed between America and Eurasia, bands of North American horses trekked far into Asia, Africa, and Europe. Eventually, once a connective bridge formed in the south, they would also emigrate to South America. 10 million years after horses emerged, another family of recognizable animals developed from American mammal radiation during the Eocene, 54.8 to 33.7 million years ago. Camels spent the first 40 million years of their evolution exclusively in North America, evolving into many forms down the epochs until 6 million years ago, when they, too, crossed the Bering Land Bridge into Asia, eventually reaching Africa. Camelops, the one- and two-humped camels along with the llamas and alpacas of South America, persisted in its original continent until roughly 10,000 years ago. The late species known as yesterday's camel ranged from Tennessee to Alaska and across almost every modern Western state. With 40 million years of presence and only 10,000 years of absence, camels are more American than many of the animals we now consider essential members of our bestiary. Another characteristic post-Chicxulub native, although its size, form, and speed cause many to believe it's some close cousin of the antelopes and gazelles of Africa, is the pronghorn. Despite convergent evolution independently fashioning gazelles and pronghorns, the American family did not produce true antelopes. The antilocapridae evolved in North America 25 million years ago, just before the onset of the Miocene, but its earlier kinship is murky. Paleontologists don't agree on an older provenance of animals that are part antelope, part goat. Probably pronghorns are offspring of an older superfamily, the Cervoidea, which would make them distantly related to deer. But there is a theory that their closest living relatives are in the Giraffidae, since giraffe legs bear a resemblance to pronghorn legs. Fossil records in North America indicate that there were two major subfamilies of these speedy grassland runners. One of those, the Antilocapridae, sported four and sometimes six horns. A dwarf four-horned version, not much larger than a jackrabbit, still sprinted across the grass plains 10,000 years ago. Another indigenous American spawn whose history would eventually join with that of global humanity was the pinnipeds, the animals that became seals and sea lions. Pinnipeds evolved as coastal-dwelling, ocean-hunting carnivores along the Pacific shores of western North America in the very early Miocene. Numerous species among the sea lions and seals would spread from their North American origins around much of the world during the Pliocene, 5.3 to 1.8 million years ago, and Pleistocene, 1.8 million to 10,000 years ago. But the most important of the American pinnipeds historically was the species known as the northern fur seal. By a million years ago, fur seal rookeries extended along the whole of America's Pacific coast and in an arc across the North Pacific to the Sea of Japan. Barking, swimming, hunting, breeding, pinnipeds joined members of the genus Enhydra. The sleek, beautiful sea otters, which emerged in the Miocene 5 to 7 million years ago to become the characteristic shoreline otters of the Pacific by 2 million years ago. Beavers and squirrels were yet another result of North American evolutionary radiation. Proto-beavers began to appear in America early in the post-Chicxulub world during the late Eocene, 56 to 33.9 million years ago. They then made the passage across the Bering Land Bridge to Eurasia, only to return to their evolutionary homeland later, a pattern followed by several other American natives. Beaver radiation over the epochs produced versions that tunneled and versions that build dams. During the Pleistocene, a type known as Castoroides that was roughly the size of a Volkswagen Beetle inhabited all America, Florida to Alaska. Squirrels might seem too small and commonplace to have been historical actors, but they are on the stage frequently in the American story. The earliest fossil evidence for squirrels comes out of western North America at the end of the Eocene, 36 million years ago, followed by a rapid divergence across the next 5 million years along with their appearance in distant Europe. Although, we're not sure just how they got there, but across several periods down to around 7 million years ago, there were forests on the land bridge between Alaska and Siberia, facilitating tree and flying squirrel passage. After that, land bridge tundra would still have allowed ground squirrel migrations between the continents. All these American natives made up a rich world of horses and camels, beavers and squirrels, seals and sea otters during the Miocene. Their predators, whose stories I tell below, were almost all migrants from Asia until the Pliocene, 5.3 to 2.6 million years ago. At that point, another indigenous family, the predatory canids emerged to make America an even more familiar place. The legendary canidae family, the wolves and dogs of the world, evolved in southwestern North America from ancestral forms at the very start of the Pliocene. Early canid versions that became gray wolves, jackals, and wild dogs eventually crossed to Asia, Europe, and Africa. The canids that never left, or in the case of Pleistocene coyotes got no farther than Siberia, became North America's distinctive coyotes, red wolves, and eastern wolves, a clade of animals that make up what biologists call allotaxa, related species that readily hybridize. Members of the canidae shared the continent with another indigenous American wolf, the strapping 150-pound and legendary dire wolf. It evolved earlier, 5.6 million years ago, and recent genetic analysis indicates it belonged to a different genus than Canis. Late in the Pleistocene, between 30,000 and 15,000 years ago, dire wolves and the clade of coyotes and American wolves would be joined by migrating waves of gray wolves returning home from Eurasia after 3 million years of evolution there. All these canids were pack hunters and scavengers, and their interactions with one another around a found carcass, or when one group made a kill that attracted others, must have been one of the grand defining spectacles of Pleistocene America. A dramatic assortment of post-Chicxulub creatures from elsewhere on Earth eventually began joining those that evolved in America to create the exotic bestiary humans found here. The conditions that made their arrival possible form the next act of America's story. Astrobiologists formulating scenarios for life on distant planets are coming to believe that oceans may be an unsuspected key to the diversity of life. Oceanic swirling transfers biotic energy around planets. In Earth's case, its own aqueous swirling has been augmented by the fact that long ago in Earth's history, the planet's outer shell cracked. Once life evolved, it began drifting around on the giant crustal shards whose island-like isolation amplified diversity. A fundamental principle of our planet's evolution is that the larger shards, perhaps because of the intense competition for niches there, tend to produce the best colonizers. North America's receptivity to migrants has been shaped by planetary plate tectonics in another way. As the shard known as the Pacific Plate has dived into America's western coastline, it has produced a singular deformation, crumpling up major mountain ranges that have oriented at topographical right angles to the pressure. North-south ranges mean the northern hemisphere's jet stream can funnel frigid Arctic air, the dreaded Polar Express, deep into America's southern latitudes. The consequence is that Asian species had an advantage over those from both Europe and South America in filling North American niches after Chicxulub. Oceanic swirling continued as a grand force. As the shards of crustal Earth broke into smaller pieces, their locations could alter the swirling of oceans and biotic energy. During the Miocene, one such plate orientation on the far side of the Earth transformed the possibilities for migrations and biological life as a whole in North America. 40 million years after Chicxulub, down in the southern hemisphere, the shard that became Australia rode free of Antarctica. That separation allowed icy water from the Antarctic to pour northward into the world's oceans, accompanied by cold, arid air that cooled and dried the planet and began to pile up ice atop the opposite pole. Miocene Earth had begun as a hothouse, roughly 8 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than now. But as the epoch progressed, cooling and drying in Asia and North America began to promote extensive mesic savanna grasslands. In much of eastern America, deciduous forests of oak and beech began to replace conifers. This biotic makeover, precipitated by drifting crust and new oceanic currents, fashioned new ecosystems that drew new mammals and birds from both hemispheres. Land connections between Asia and America had come and gone before, but as ice began to gobble up water, the old pattern intensified. During cold episodes, the ocean levels dropped, exposing a wide northern bridge, Beringia, from Siberia into Alaska. 17 million years ago, that bridge brought North America a prodigious early immigrant, our continent's first elephants. These early arrivals were the great mastodons, browse eaters who gravitated to heavy forests in the western mountains, the upper Midwest, and the whole eastern half of the continent. Among other important Miocene arrivals from Asia were the deer and elk that would become such crucial players in North American ecology and history. The cervoids had emerged in Asia in the Oligocene epoch, 33.7 to 23.8 million years ago. Various versions, including the ancestors of whitetail and mule deer, began arriving in North America about the same time as the mastodons. The largest, elk, were similar to red deer in Europe, but America's elk sprang from an Asian population in Kazakhstan, Mongolia, and Siberia. The line separating European red deer and American elk appears to lie through the Gobi Desert. As for the biggest deer, the moose, from Oligocene beginnings, they ranged across Europe to the Caucasus Mountains, and from there, through Manchuria and Siberia to Alaska. A deer that prefers woods with a seasonal snow cover, moose took up residence from Alaska to New England and as far south as Colorado during the Miocene. The caribou migrating by our camps in the Arctic Wildlife Refuge in the summer of 2019 occupy an intriguing niche in the story of cervoids in North America. While ancestral cervoids came to America out of Asia, caribou evolved into their modern form in Beringia itself on the land bridge during the late Pliocene some 2 million years ago. A herding deer in which both males and females sport antlers, caribou colonized in both directions, westward into Mongolia and China, and eastward across Canada and Atlantic land bridges to Greenland, Ireland, Scotland, and Scandinavia. During the Pleistocene and after, isolated caribou herds in America became genetically and behaviorally distinct. The Alaskan herds we were among are closest to the original Beringia caribou, but there were woodland caribou that in time would get as far south as Nevada, New Mexico, Tennessee, and Alabama. Caribou, it turns out, make clicking sounds in their legs as they walk as a dominance display to establish hierarchy in the herds. Another large family, the Bovidae, including sheep and goats, as well as muskox and bison, had its beginnings in Africa and Europe in the early Miocene. The late Miocene drought, climate historians call it the Messinian crisis, produced an extensive global spread of savanna grasslands, the catalyst to an evolutionary radiation of Bovidae forms. In North America 5 million years ago, Miocene drying produced an enormous interior grassland, the Great Plains, east of the Rocky Mountains. An American Serengeti of immense distances, with opalescent mountain uplifts on its western horizon and vast rippling tracts of yellow grasslands, this country soon began to fill with grazers, many of which were different species of Bovidae dispersing from Asia. This migration continued for many millions of years and brought to America some of its most dramatic historic era mammals. Among these drought-propelled migrants were the North American wild sheep. Separating from goats some 4 million years in the past, wild sheep arrived in America in the Pleistocene about 1.5 million years ago. Paleontologists believe the first sheep in the New World were an offshoot of the Argali sheep of the Asiatic steppes. Once here, they evolved into three major types that inhabited America's arid western mountains, Great Plains, Badlands, and southwestern cliffs. Another late arrival was the musk ox, which evolved in Siberia and moved across the land bridge as far east as Hudson's Bay during the Pleistocene. Still another was an antelope goat that in America became known as the Rocky Mountain goat. Once in America, these pure white goats spread from the high mountains of southeastern Alaska through the Pacific Northwest to California and eastward into the mountains of Montana, adding a very late arrival competitor in the high country haunts of wild sheep. Ironically, in light of the iconic and symbolic nature of mammoths and bison in American history, these two were among the last animal immigrants here out of Asia. Recent DNA analysis of North American mammoth remains indicates that all our early mammoths sprang from populations of cold-adapted steppe mammoths that were native to northeastern Siberia and were descendants of North Asia's grassland-adapted elephants. As grazers, In America, mammoths and bison gravitated to the northern tundra as well as the immense savannas farther south. Both fossil and genetic evidence shows that mammoths found their way to America in the Pleistocene about 1.5 million years ago. The oldest genomic evidence science has so far analyzed from any species, extracted from tooth cores between 400,000 and roughly a million years old, indicate the Colombian mammoths that ranged south of the ice sheets were in fact hybrids of more northerly woolly mammoths and a previously unknown mammoth species. The explanation for these regional forms seems to be natural selection for versions adapted to the dramatically different ecologies north and south of the Pleistocene ice sheets, perhaps aided by gene flow from bulls that were particularly successful breeders. Given their late arrival, mammoths were never as distinctively American as camels or horses, but their size and roles as keystone vegetation engineers made them crucial players in our big history. Bison came to America later still. The oldest bison-like fossils are associated with southern Asia in the late Pliocene, 2 million years ago. A now extinct species with a double hump and sweeping horns, the steppe bison, which appears in paleontological literature as Bison priscus, was likely the first Old World bison to enter North America. Bison priscus and its descendants spread eastward into Europe too, but it was the American versions that would claim the spotlight. Latecomers they may have been, bison conveyed the idea of America to the world like no other animal. Along with genetic analysis, recent fossil work has produced the somewhat shocking conclusion that the earliest bison arrived here only 300,000 years ago, and likely as recently as 130,000 years ago. Once they crossed into an America where horses and mammoths were their only grazing competition, steppe bison apparently underwent an ecological release, quickly adapting to widely divergent settings both north and south of the glacial sheets. An impressive longhorn version, B. latifrons, was extinct by 20,000 years ago to be replaced by a southerly Pleistocene form known as B. antiquus, the very beasts taken down with fluted points at the Folsom site. All those grazers attracted other Asian families that would become iconic Americans, our bears and cats. America's first bears reached the continent roughly 8 million years ago. They separated into white bears in the circumpolar Arctic and black bears in tree country, where the latter could escape harassment from bigger bears by climbing. At least some inland white bears evolved into grizzly bears 200,000 years ago, except for a population that clung to the coasts, feeding on beached whales and the fish that spawned in interior rivers, a type sometimes called brown bears. Grizzlies would join that Pleistocene terror, the short-faced bear, to spread as far as open country and ungulate populations extended in the American interior. 800-pound short-faced bears occupied their own genus, Arctidus. All the other American bears were related enough to be members of the genus Ursus. Felis cats, the ancestors of cougars and lynx and bobcats, were in America long before the bears, their progenitor forms arriving from Asia about 35 million years ago, at the end of the Eocene. Among the spreading herds of ungulates in the late Miocene, one American, Felidae, replicated African savanna cat evolution, becoming the pronghorn's nightmare, the American cheetah. It was most closely related to today's cougars. There were also the panthera cats, evolved with a special morphology in their larynxes that enabled roaring. Pantherin cats emerged in northern Asia 10 million years ago and got to America late in the Pleistocene, where they produced a magnificent lion along with a distinctive roaring American cat, the jaguar. The largest cat to evolve in American ecologies, it's still the third largest cat on Earth. Jaguars sprang from a pantherin progenitor about 1.5 million years ago, then spread from the Pacific Northwest through both American continents. Impressive as jaguars were and are, the most memorable and famous of all of America's giant cats were the saber-tooths, which first became carnivorous terrors here 2.5 million years ago. Smilodon gracilis of Eastern America was the runt of the group, reaching only about 225 pounds. But at 615 pounds, significantly larger than an African lion, S. fetilis, endemic to Western America, was a creature out of horror fantasy, its massive canine teeth designed to slash into its prey and rip them open. These various cats, along with the bears and the several canids that had evolved in America, plus old world hunting hyenas that followed the herds across Beringia, became hunters of pronghorns as well as of mammoth calves. They also pursued horses, especially colts, camels, and those other new migrants from Asia, elk, deer, and sheep. 4.5 million years ago, when ebbing seas allowed Panama's isthmus to form several separate islands and link North and South America, Earth's newest connection provided another dramatic highway for the exchange of life. It allowed horses, camels, and canids to travel into the southern continent, and it brought ground sloths, including several species of giant ones, opossums, and armadillos, northward. The isthmus also provided a flyway for some of the tropic's brightest, most colorful birds to join the bird life of North America. Birds that became Americans followed all the patterns mammals did. The modern bird families evolved from ground-dwelling ancestors emerging after the Chicxulub strike, and with the occupants of so many niches destroyed, North America became the destination for a spread of bird life from elsewhere, particularly when ocean levels were low and land bridges existed. Given their outsized roles in the historical story, some of America's classic bird life merits an especially close understanding. Until a century ago, passenger pigeons were the most numerous birds on Earth. We ought to know them well. Eagles, condors, wild turkeys, hummingbirds, and a pair of natural superstars, our remarkable parrot and giant woodpecker, also deserve our full attention. The Northern Hemisphere penguin, the great auk, ranged across the North Atlantic, but it hunted and nested down America's Atlantic coast to Florida. And there are the prairie chickens, including the eastern type known as the heath hen, that loom large in American history. The stories of many of these birds appear in the chapters to come. Modern genetics is pushing America's bird past into new frontiers. From genomic work on passenger pigeon specimens started in 2012, we now think America's most characteristic bird derived from a pigeon ancestor that arrived from Asia during the mid-Miocene, 15 million years ago. Once here, the ancestral pigeons diverged into two types. One, which became the bandtail, homing in on the more Asian-like west. The other adapting so well to the enormous biomass of the deciduous forests of Eastern America that, like marine birds, it began to nest in giant communal flocks. No one is sure just how long ago passenger pigeon populations began to skyrocket. Genetic modeling indicates that they existed in immense flocks with a very healthy diversity for at least the past 50,000 years. Pigeon flocks moving at 60 miles per hour and casting shadows hundreds of miles long across the American landscape were an ancient phenomenon. America's biggest raptors, the eagles, trace their ancestral origins to the Eocene, when eagles separated from fish-hunting kites. Booted eagles with feathers to their talons eventually emerged as distinct types. The fossils of the classic American eagle, the bald eagle, appear here as far back as a million years ago. A 15-pound raptor that can live for almost 40 years, the bald eagle has sailed the skies scanning for prey on an 8-foot wingspan since the Pleistocene. Like the golden eagle, its dryland relative, white-headed bald eagles were the avian T. rexes of post-dinosaur America. For a million years, they scattered their 1,000-pound nests from one side of North America to the other. California condors are another purely American type, not related to the vultures of Eurasia and Africa. They and related forms evolved here during the mid-Miocene to fill a niche provided by growing numbers of ungulate carcasses. America's condor ancestors were related to Andean condors, but the California condor's genus, Gymnogyps, is distinctive and at least 40,000 years old. Early species were even larger than the existing bird, but fossils of today's condors are common from the rich American bestiary of the late Pleistocene, which provided them with coast-to-coast scavenging abundance, a circumstance in which they clearly thrived. Closely associated with both Native America and colonial American history, wild turkeys present a complex story. The assumption has long been that America's wild turkeys are actually a kind of giant Eurasian pheasant. If so, they have been hyphenated Eurasian Americans for a very long time, likely developing their turkeyness here. Early turkey ancestors migrated into North America around the beginning of the Miocene, but the oldest fossil evidence for them, curiously, is not from Alaska, but from Florida. Fossils in the direct line to more modern wild turkeys date to the Pliocene, about 5 million years ago. But the Pleistocene, there were three principal types in America. One, associated with woodlands in the east. One, a drylands turkey. And a third, Meleagris californica, a now extinct wild turkey that paleontologists know well because its remains are common at La Brea tar pits. Dramatic as so many were, no American birds would ultimately stun human eyes and ears like hummingbirds. Found in the Americas and nowhere else in the world, hummers originally evolved in Europe, arriving in North America via Beringia about 1 million years ago, and evolving into more than 300 different species. Meanwhile, they went extinct in their original evolutionary home. Along with their tiny size, color vision, and rapier bills adapted to foraging for nectar among America's wildflowers, hummingbirds evolved a flight acceleration of as much as 9 G-forces, the highest known for any vertebrate on Earth, all with minuscule wings that also took them on epic migrations up and down the continent. Since most birds are flyers, land bridges weren't always essential for bird colonization, but they helped. The tropical parrots that spawned America's Carolina parakeets or woodpeckers evolving in the tropics could easily colonize northward into suitable American habitats. As for North America's dramatic parrots, the Carolina parakeet, a lucky sequencing of its genome from a preserved leg fragment in 2019 revealed its origins as a relative of South America's sun parakeet. Green and yellow Carolina parakeets split from that species 3 million years ago. Swooping through the forests in dense flocks like festive flying blankets, they colonized North America once the Isthmus of Panama pointed the way. By the time humans got here, America's parrots had separated into two subspecies, one associated with the rivers of the Lower West, the other extending from the bayous of the Gulf South northward along the Atlantic coast, providing brilliant life to forests all the way to the Hudson River. The newest genomic work on America's giant woodpecker, the ivory bill, indicates its ancestral antecedents come from the American tropics as well. During the Pleistocene, one population crossed to Cuba, another settled into the Sierra Madre in Mexico to become the imperial woodpecker, and a third flew north to become America's legendary ivory bills. America's new land bridge in Central America was yet another contingency that changed the history of wild America. The closing of the isthmus diverted ocean water northward, which sucked more moisture and rain up the coasts toward the Arctic. That contributed to another grand effect endemic to the planet. It fashioned the Earth of the Ice Ages. Our planet does not rotate perfectly around its axis. Its gyroscopic twirling produces what's known as precession, which means our sphere wobbles slightly, like a spinning top losing momentum. Across time, that wobbling spin tilts the poles away from exact true, which subtly alters the angles at which sunlight strikes the planet. With increased moisture now flowing up America's coasts to the Arctic, those tilts began to produce climatic swings at intervals from 10,000 years up to 40,000. We know these as part of the Milankovitch cycles. Named after an early 20th century Serbian geographer who studied axial tilt, along with how gravitational pull from the giant planets Jupiter and Saturn alter Earth's orbit, these cycles and the enhanced moisture produced a new situation for the Northern Hemisphere. An age of expanding, then retreating polar ice was at hand, a grand phenomenon that would by turns freeze North America and bury half of it in ice, then warm it dramatically, then freeze it again. Ice ages and the warm pluvials between them stirred natural selection and repeatedly opened and closed the doorways for new life forms passing from the rest of the world into America. Life, for example, like that emerging in faraway Africa. To consider the natural history of humans in our wild animal form, we have to drop early into our story. At some unremarkable time in Earth's Miocene epoch, between 8 and 6 million years ago, a branch of primates in Africa began to diverge from the limb that had produced chimps and apes of the deep forests. With their basic forest adaptations intact, the new hominids, the term for the various genera in our line, began to probe into the grassy, scattered forestlands that Miocene aridity was producing. They possessed a body structure, grasping hands, and stereoscopic vision adapted for moving through and standing upright in trees. Like birds and butterflies, they saw in color to recognize ripe fruits. As tropical apes, they liked 72-degree Fahrenheit temperatures. They preserved a troop-like life of intense and complex social interactions, which fostered a body-brain chemistry of dopamines and serotonins as catalysts for diverse, motivating emotions. Look at a sunset and appreciate its color. Grip a steering wheel with thumb and fingers. Check the thermostat setting. Each one of these is enabled by these holdovers from our long-ago African origins. Science fiction is rife with scenarios wherein intelligent aliens observing Earth barely noticed these primates of 6 million years ago. But the changes the planet was undergoing in the Miocene created new, more open ecological conditions all over the globe. And if the aliens paid the sort of attention smart aliens should, they might have noticed something interesting. By at minimum 3.5 million years ago, likely for 500,000 years before that, these primates were walking upright. An 80-foot-long trail of two sets of fossilized footprints from then, found near Olduvai Gorge, attests to that. These bipedal primates were now on the road to becoming travelers, a cosmopolitan species for whom all of Earth beckoned. At the height of the Pliocene, African hominids were becoming something their descendants recognize. They were Australopithecines, no longer quadrupeds balancing on their knuckles, and now living in open country full of predatory danger. Walking upright makes you look larger. It also enables seeing far and exposes less of the body to the sun. But most important, walking upright frees the arms and grasping hands to carry things. Not only food things, but any manner of objects. Australopithecine dental wear suggests their large intestines were still designed for a fibrous, chimp-like diet. But out in the drier grasslands, hominid fare began including seeds and nuts, enhancing the small intestines' processing of lipid-like fatty acids. That turned out to be important. As for the things to carry, simple found tools for crushing nuts and seeds begin to show up about 3.4 million years ago. They were a step toward the tools we would later use to slit animal hides and crack bones. Not everyone is thrilled to hear this, but this progression made us carnivores and predators. Every step fostered feedback loops that began to change us. In several different species, the Australopithecines survived across some 2 million years, during which time they began to make tools by chipping sharp flakes off rock cores, Olduvai tools named after Olduvai Gorge. Isotope studies of their bones show a strong C4 signal, indicating a diet made up in part of grazing animals. They also appear to have acquired tapeworms, undoubtedly by eating flesh that cats and canids had also bitten into. As the Pleistocene dawned 2.5 million years ago, a taller, even more upright creature emerged in the hominid line and appears to have outplayed the Australopithecines at this new game. The new beings were part of a genus we now call Homo, which includes several species, the latest count is 20, of hominins, different but related members of our own biological animal. Now, as Homo, our ancestors were about to undergo profound changes that enhanced and refined our success in the ecological niche we'd chosen. Those changes came directly from the deaths of other animals that surrounded us in the world. It really was quite remarkable. A primate undergoing rapid reinvention by feeding itself on animal fat and protein was becoming the newest planet-changing contingency in Earth's history of life. In the 21st century, We do not look at one another and say to ourselves, "So, another confrontational scavenger to swap stories with." And yet there is good evidence that across Australopithecine and early Homo stages, we engaged in a lifestyle built around scavenging found or stolen animal carcasses. Chimps and bonobos, and a great many species we don't consider carnivorous, take advantage of fat and protein from meat whenever it's available to them. Chimps make meat available by hunting smaller primates like colobus monkeys and bush babies. But in an Africa that was much like the present continent, with great herds of ungulates and cat and canid predators, our ancestors' first adaptation was to become hyena-like scavengers. We weren't just another scavenger among the vultures, waiting our turn. Early hominins perfected the nuances of confrontational scavenging. Your stomach is fluttering for good reason. Primates are classic prey for big cats. The only chance hominins had of confronting big predators and stealing their kills meant organizing into groups, like hyena packs, large enough to be intimidating. Then doing the primate thing of brandishing sticks and hurling stones. If imagining driving lions and leopards off their kills doesn't raise the hairs on your neck, contemplate this. The human genome includes a gene called APOE that in four variants is found among all human populations. About 13% of Americans from Northern European backgrounds possess the ancestral hominin version of APOE that produces high cholesterol levels, coronary heart disease, and rapid cognitive decline, which is the primary reason we know so much about this gene. But in our situation 2 million years ago, those were side effects. The ancestral version of APOE actually evolved as an advantage, triggering the hominin immune system to fight off particular kinds of peptides found in foods swarming with bacteria. And why would we have needed that? Because this gene enabled us to survive scavenging meat and animal parts that were in a state of decay. The human disgust response, evolved to protect us from poisoning ourselves, appears to date from roughly the same time. Not so long after Homo emerged, what paleoanthropologists call persistent hominin carnivory began to replace scavenging. That must have been momentous, because attacking living animals can be far more dangerous than scavenging. It was a feat our ancestors managed despite lacking the speed, power, and jaws and carnassial teeth of other predators. Predatory success implies that we performed this transformation not as solitary hunters like leopards, but as pack hunters, now resembling lion prides or canid packs rather than hyenas. That kind of cooperation worked inside a feedback loop involving brain power. In less than 500,000 years ago, Homo brains grew 70% by volume and were burning up a quarter of hominin intake energy. It was animal fat and protein that grew those outsized brains, and it was carnivory, along with the cooperative, social lives this new savanna economy demanded, that selected for that brainy intelligence. In the backyard of my house, a few miles south of Santa Fe, New Mexico, is a 300-foot deep canyon my dog and I cross to the mesa where we run. I have traversed this canyon and run on this mesa for years, and today with Cody already on the trail home, I indulge a slightly unusual act on my cool-down walk. It's a simple thing, but it's a grand genetic inheritance from deep time. As I walk, I scan the trail for rocks of a special type, preferably round, ideally the size and weight of a golf ball. These are not rocks to collect. They are rocks to throw, and 6 or 8 times as I return from today's run, I find the best grip I can on the rocks I've gathered and uncork throws at distant boulders. For me, the act of throwing is a muscle memory from childhood, later refined by high school and college sports. It's a physicality I've always possessed and have never given up. As I perform the complex ballet of a throw, the foot opposite my throwing arm lifts and points at the target. My hips rotate as my weight shifts forward from my back foot, and with a whip-like motion from shoulder and arm, I arc a projectile across sunlit space. I think, what an ancient act this is. We inherited our ability to throw from earlier primates. But In a change from their body design, evolution fashioned late hominins with shoulder sockets that attach our arms on the outside of our bodies rather than on the top or front. That design, plus the premium on balance and coordination our upright stance gave us, allowed hominins to throw objects with great force and accuracy. Around 1.8 million years ago, we started crafting weapons to throw, initially the grapefruit-sized sharpened rock tools archaeologists call Acheulean hand axes. Either hand axes were awesome executors of hominin needs, or no one could figure out how to improve them, because for the next 1.5 million years, they hardly changed. The most ancient Acheulean hand axes are from locales like the Rift Valley of Kenya and Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania, where they seemed to serve as the original Swiss Army knife. Our ancestors used a version to grind seeds and another to slice into animal hides, butcher flesh, break open bones. They served as weapons of defense, warfare, and murder, and supersized ones perhaps even for ritual. Archaeologists have found scores of them around ancient waterholes, where they must have been thrown in volleys to fell gazelles and impalas. Those moments, lost to us across a yawning abyss of time, were profound. Our relationship with the animals around us had changed. We had joined the Predator Guild, and for the first time, began to produce fear in other animals. Since we're unable to recreate the inner consciousness of a Homo species from 1 million years ago, there is no way of telling the psychological impact of this reversal. But it's a good guess that the initial idea of an afterlife, where death is not the final act, may have entered hominin minds with an emotion of remorse at confronting a beautiful animal that one instant was living and striving and, in another, lay soundless and unmoving. Comparing body designs, along with butchering as the act that followed a kill, surely drove home how similar all other animals were to ourselves. The hominins inherited from primate ancestors a slight sexual dimorphism, and that had consequences in the predatory economy. Certainly capable females must have been good at the hunt. Planning hunt strategies no doubt was gender neutral, and carrying out those strategies included both females and children in hominid bands. But actual pursuit of prey was more often the task of the classic primate male troop, which over time may have hardened into a gender role. Male hominins hunted. Some females did, but others performed tasks that could be done in conjunction with childcare. Among modern hunter-gatherers, meat and other animal products are a privileged resource, more important than plant foods. Sharing animal flesh with other members of the group would have been central to creating social status. No doubt that translated to sexual success for those who excelled, regardless of gender, which would be a driver that continuously refined the predatory economy. Lives as predators forever changed us. Our primate ancestors had lived in dread of predators, a fear we yet feel. But now they had ascended the trophic pyramid. This wild, fierce life made hominins bigger, more physical, better athletes. Yet another advantage of standing upright was that it made hominins much faster runners. Their 20-mile-per-hour sprinting abilities weren't so impressive when a gazelle could run 60 miles per hour, but few creatures had such endurance. Their hearts changed from the thick chimp organs designed for brief spurts of energy to the thinner, supple, more elastic hearts of long-distance runners. They gradually lost their body hair, developed sweat glands. The ancient versions of us became taller, thinner, more gracile, and more wolf-like. Both we and wolves retain from lives of running down prey, a phenomenon we know today as runner's high, a buzz from the body's release of natural endocannabinoids. Evidence is also growing that, by moderating the effects of the APOE gene, the cursorial lifestyle led to an increase in the hominin lifespan beyond the reproductive stage, a phenomenon anthropologists refer to as the grandmother effect. Around 800,000 years ago, our ancestors took a step that perhaps contributed to an initial sense that we were different from other animals. We began to control fire and put it to purpose. With fire, hominin bands could deflect predators. They could manipulate ecologies. They could look for prey animals in places no one had ever gone, explore colder regions by, in effect, taking the setting where hominins evolved along on the journey, and with fire, they could transform the flesh of the animals by cooking. A step anthropologists from Claude Lévi-Strauss to Carlton Kuhn believe was crucial in the predatory economy. So, bringing fire, the flickering agent of destruction and creation, under control. Exploring a world became more vast than any hominin could imagine, and killing other creatures, cooking and eating their flesh. How could these proto-humans not develop some sense they were superior to all they beheld, a master life form in a world brimming with creatures now delivered into their grasp? As North America took on a form we might recognize, in Africa, various species of Homo were now on the move. Keystone carnivores, capable of affecting prey populations, we, for now our ancestors were becoming us, began to search for unexploited animal populations. We learned to construct shelters, and at some point the clever among us figured out how to make awls and needles to sew animal skins into fitted clothing. In a development eerily similar to the way NASA is today calculating how humans can survive on Mars, our technologies meant we could, in effect, take Africa with us wherever we went. These were technologies that allowed tropical apes to colonize new worlds. Roughly 800,000 years ago, hominins not very different from fellow passengers we see on the subway began to push out of the original homeland and into the bigger world. Earlier bands of hominins, Homo erectus, had already attempted an African exodus, getting to the Black Sea nearly 2 million years ago, and eventually to Spain and Indonesia. But the movement into Eurasia of bands of hominins known as Homo antecessor, and eventually another hominin derived from them, H. heidelbergensis, finally sent members of our genus deep into the largest landmass on Earth. That prepared history, at some fecund moment around 500,000 years ago, for two new hominins to begin their thousands of years of mastery of the different, colder, but animal-rich country north of Africa. They were the Denisovans and the Neanderthals, being so closely related to us modern-day humans that most of us still carry their genes, coding that influences our height, our body hair, or lack of it, even our susceptibility or resistance to particular diseases. Fossil sites and genomic analysis for Denisovan populations farther east in Europe and Asia are still in their early stages, but we've come to know a great deal about Neanderthals since the first site with their fascinating remains surfaced in Germany in 1856. There are now scores of their sites, from the Middle East to Northern Europe, thousands of their bones in museum collections, and at least 19 sequenced Neanderthal genomes. At every stage of discovery, they become more intriguing and ever more enigmatic. The first observation about them may come as a shock, but it rests on the inescapable fact that for many of us in the 21st century, as much as 2.5% of our genes, and not the same 2.5% from one of us to the next, derives from them. Genetic analysis is indicating so many episodes of hybridization between these late hominins and ourselves, at least 4 episodes of gene exchange between Denisovans and modern humans, and another 4 between us and Neanderthals. The events starting as early as 300,000 years ago and continuing down to 40,000 years ago, that a 2021 study in Science posed the question of whether archaic and modern human should be regarded as distinct lineages. If it is more accurate to think of Neanderthals, Denisovans, modern humans as a continuum of biological diversity instead of truly separate species, if we were all becoming versions of one another, then the story of these early humans becomes even more gravid. The fossil evidence we have indicates they were on the whole slightly different, bigger than us. 23andMe says I'm taller because of their genes. Built as heavier, long-distance walkers rather than runners, and designed by natural selection as predators. Nitrogen isotopes taken from Neanderthal bones show them to have been remarkably predacious, as carnivorous as wolves or hyenas. There is abundant evidence they preyed on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.